My name is Dr. Kayla Kaiser from California State University, Northridge. The objectives of this video are first, to understand the concept of a state function, and second, to master the use of Hess's law in calculations of reaction enthalpies. Images and thermodynamic data used in this video are from our textbook, Chemistry, a Molecular Approach by Nivaldo Tro. A quantity is called a state function when it is path independent. In this image, hikers could take path A, which is longer, 12 miles, with many switchbacks, or path B, which is shorter, only 5 miles, but has a steep incline. Regardless of their path, hikers will arrive at the pinnacle, whether they take path A or B. Hence, altitude is a state function, while distance is not. It is often convenient to describe chemical reactions with energy diagrams. In an energy diagram, the vertical axis represents the overall energy of the system, while the horizontal axis represents progress of the reaction from reactants to products. The energy diagram shown here traces only one possible path, and it is clear that the reaction is exothermic since the products are stabilized relative to the reactants. The enthalpy of this reaction is negative 241.8 kilojoules per mole. Since enthalpy is a state function, the change in enthalpy for a chemical reaction is the same whether the reaction takes place in one step or a series of steps. The statement is known as Hess's law. When chemists talk about the thermodynamics of a reaction, we are concerned with the difference in energy between reactants and products, and whether a reaction is downhill, energy releasing, or uphill, energy absorbing. Some reactions, like the combustion of hydrogen gas, need a little push to get started, but once ignited, the products form quickly, accompanied by a release of energy in the form of heat, light, and sound. We're going to look at another combustion reaction that is used in welding, the exothermic conversion of ethine, also known as acetylene, which burns at 3,500 degrees Celsius, or 6,330 degrees Fahrenheit. We're going to apply Hess's law to this reaction in three ways. The first approach to applying Hess's law involves tabulated enthalpies of formation. The standard enthalpy of formation of a compound is the change of enthalpy by forming one mole of the compound from its constituent elements, with all substances in their standard states under one atmosphere of pressure and at some specified temperature, which is usually 25 degrees Celsius. These values are in kilojoules per mole of a substance, so we need to use the stoichiometric coefficients of the reaction in this type of Hess's law calculation. You can find standard enthalpies of formation in the appendix of your textbook containing thermodynamic data. Most enthalpies of formation are exothermic or heat releasing, since as compounds form, there is a gain in stability. However, for the formation of some unstable compounds, or those with a high chemical potential energy, the enthalpy of formation may be endothermic. For elements in their standard states, such as diatomic oxygen gas, the enthalpy of formation is zero. For the combustion of acetylene, we need to multiply the enthalpy of formation of one mole of carbon dioxide by the energy released upon its formation by the number of moles of carbon dioxide in the combustion reaction, which is 4 moles. In a similar manner, we use the coefficient 2 in front of gaseous water and multiply that by its enthalpy of formation. These are our products. For the reactants, 2 moles of acetylene are multiplied by its enthalpy of formation, 227.4 kilojoules per mole. And since oxygen gas is in its elemental form, it neither requires nor releases energy and therefore has an enthalpy of formation equal to zero. Taking the sum of the enthalpy of formation of the products minus the sum of the enthalpy of formation of the reactants, we arrive at an estimation of the enthalpy for the combustion reaction, a negative 2,512.4 kilojoules, indicating that the reaction is exothermic. This reaction releases about 10 times more energy than the combustion of hydrogen gas. The second approach to applying Hess's law can be used when a table of possible reaction steps and the corresponding enthalpy changes for each step are provided. Reaction mechanisms are step-by-step descriptions of what occurs on a molecular level in chemical reactions. A reaction mechanism is only a guess at how a reaction proceeds. These topics will become important in subsequent chemistry courses, but for now, understand that this is a second way of applying Hess's law, and it works because enthalpy is a state function, that is, it is path independent. In this approach, first, you want to identify the products and reactants of the goal reaction among the proposed reaction steps. Make sure that the products appear on the right side of each step, and that the reactants of the goal reaction appear on the left side of each step. If you need to reverse the direction of one of the reaction steps, in this example, reactions 3 and 5 had to be reversed. Then remember to change the sign of the enthalpy for that reaction step. This is because if a reaction in the forward direction produces heat, then when that reaction is run in reverse, it should consume heat, and vice versa. You can also reorder the reactions so that when you see an intermediate, such as calcium carbide in reaction 1 of this example, then place the calcium carbide in reaction 2 directly below it so that you can see calcium carbide will not appear in the sum, the final reaction. Next, it is necessary to adjust the stoichiometry of the reaction steps so that the steps will sum to the overall goal reaction. In this example, reactions 1, 2, 5, and 3 had to be doubled. When you carry out a reaction twice, it will generate or consume twice the amount of energy. So when you double a reaction, you must also double the enthalpy for that reaction step. And finally, to have the proper amount of oxygen as a reactant and carbon dioxide as a product for the goal reaction, reaction 4 and its enthalpy had to be multiplied by 6. When you have distributed the multipliers to each reaction and its corresponding enthalpy, you should verify that all intermediates drop out and that the reactants and products for your goal reaction are the only substances that remain. If this is true, then you can add the enthalpies of the steps to find the enthalpy of the goal reaction. The units of this result are in kilojoules. Again, we see that the enthalpy for the reaction is large and exothermic, and it is in agreement with what we calculated by the first method. The third approach to applying Hess's law that we're going to discuss in this video involves looking at the bonds broken between atoms of the reactants and the bonds formed between atoms in the products. Breaking bonds requires energy, while forming bonds, resulting in a gain in stability, releases energy. Average bond energies can be found in reference tables in your textbook. An excerpt is shown here. Pictured also in this slide is an acetylene torch cutting through a steel cable. This is the practical application of the acetylene combustion reaction that we've chosen to highlight in this video. When using the third approach to Hess's law, it is convenient to draw the structural formulas for all reactants and products using lines to represent bonds. Then you can draw a line through each bond while you are tallying up the number and type of bonds broken and formed. A common mistake when applying Hess's law in this way is that students try to use the stoichiometric coefficients as a multiplier instead of the number of bonds. For example, although 4 carbon dioxide molecules are formed, there are 8 carbon-oxygen double bonds formed. Once you have counted the number of each type of bond that is broken and formed using your line drawings, you can plug in the bond energy for each type of bond. Find the energy required or released for each type of bond, then sum the bonds broken, then sum the bonds formed. Then calculate the energy difference. In this case, the products are more stable than the reactants, so more energy is released by forming carbon dioxide and water than was stored in the bonds of the oxygen and ethane. Hence, the reaction is exothermic. The units of the result are also kilojoules. In summary, let's compare our results from the three ways of doing Hess's law shown in this video. We can see that each of these three results is large and exothermic. It is possible to measure experimentally the heat of combustion of acetylene using constant volume calorimetry. Some values obtained using a web search reveal that per mole of ethane, about 1300 kilojoules of energy are released. Since the balanced chemical equation for the combustion of ethane consumed 2 moles of ethane, we can multiply the per mole enthalpies by 2. After taking the stoichiometry of the combustion reaction into account, we find good agreement among our estimates using Hess's law and the values determined experimentally and reported in three different sources. I hope you have found this video helpful in making sense of first, the concept of a state function, and second, the use of Hess's law in calculations of reaction enthalpies. This video is unlisted. Please be considerate and think twice before sharing.